Hi friends, it's time for another Sunday devotional. I'm so glad to be here with you. I'm really excited that we continue to have these times together. Although I am still looking forward to the time when we can all come back to church and see each other face to face, it will probably be a while before we can have New Life kids again, but it will be nice when the day comes when we can at least see each other and say hi and sit in a service together. That will be a really exciting time. But until then, I'm glad that we can meet like this. I'm glad that I still have the chance to talk to you, and I hope that you are able to learn from these times together. So, before we start, I'm going to pray for us today, okay? Why don't we pray together? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for this time, for my friends who are watching this. Father, we know that these are sometimes difficult days, that the time sometimes feels like it's going by so slowly, and Lord, we don't always feel like we're doing everything that we should be doing. But God, I just pray that you will continue to remind us that you are always with us, that you are in control. Lord, and would you help us to take advantage of the time to learn more about you, to learn to love you, to love the people around us. We pray, God, that you will teach us through today's time what it means to live as Christians in this world, and pray that you would allow us to continue to learn more about you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, last week was Father's Day. I forgot to mention it, but I hope you all had a good Father's Day and really got to say thank you to your dads for all the wonderful things they're doing. We're going to go ahead and get started with a time of praise. And so I'm going to ask Teacher Praise and Caroline to lead us in a couple of songs. I hope you will be able to join along. So why don't we all stand together?
He's always there.
and teacher Caroline. As always, I really enjoy singing these songs together and really getting to praise God, even though we're not all in the same room. I hope that you're able to enjoy the songs that we've been singing. Well, friends, today we're going to continue our talk of 1 Peter. And this, you know, has not been the easiest things to talk about for kids. It's much easier to talk about some of the stories in the Old Testament. The things that we're learning now are much more about how to live every day. It's not really a story with like a hero and somebody who loses and wins. But what I want us to remember is that all of the Bible shows us who our God is. So even though the stories are sometimes more fun to listen to, I think that what we can learn from 1 Peter is just as important. And it's a wonderful time for us to learn what it means for us to live as a Christian in this world. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're reading from 1 Peter chapter 3. Last week, Pastor Will spoke from chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. I thought it was a little long, so we're going to skip a little bit in the middle, but I'm going to read some of it for us, okay? So here is 1 Peter chapter 3. I'm going to read verses 1 through 4. It says this: "Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Do not let your adorning be external," that means on the outside, "the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning," that means how you dress yourself up, "be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered." That was verse 7. So, friends, in these verses, Peter is telling us again what it looks like to live as Christians in a world where we might be surrounded by non-Christians, people who don't know Jesus. How can we show them with our lives what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus? So that's something that we all can learn, even though today's passage, if you were listening, you kind of hear it and you're like, why is that important for me? But what I want us to remember is that there's always something that we can learn about our God from the scriptures. So we read that all, and I just, again, want to remind us that all of it is meaningful for us. Sometimes some passages are a little easier to understand, and some of it we have to work out a little more, and that's what we're going to do today. So when you read this passage, were you listening to what I read? If you were, I want you to try and answer this question for me. Who is Peter talking to in this passage? Okay, think about what I just read. Who is Peter talking to? Now, if you were paying attention, you will remember that he talks to first wives, and then he talks to husbands. Now, you might say, well, I'm not a wife or a husband. Maybe your moms and dads, you know, you could say, oh yeah, mommy's a wife and daddy's a husband, but what about me? But we're going to talk about why this passage is also important to all of us, okay? So the first thing that I want to tell us is that Peter in this passage is, first of all, he talks to the wives, or he talks to women. And friends, that is very important, and I'm going to explain to you why. In the Bible times, women were not considered the same as men. Women were considered not as important. So in those times, people did not talk directly to women. If you were writing a letter or if you were speaking in public, you weren't really talking to the women. You would only be talking to the men. So normally, other people, like in the government, the emperor, or whoever, wouldn't talk to women, because women were considered to be under their husbands, okay? So it was only the husbands and the men who would be spoken to, not the women. Why is that important for us today, friends? It is important because Peter speaks directly to the women in the church, the women in Asia Minor, those Christians. He speaks directly to them. He talks to them, and he speaks to them as people, as equal with men. And that was not normal back then. And so what that means for us, friends, is that the gospel, the good news about Jesus, means that we are all important and we are all equal before God. We were all made in his image. And that is really, really important, friends, because back then they would say, women, you're not as important because you're not a man. But Peter says that's not true, because in Jesus, you are so important and you matter to God. And he spoke directly to them. Now, if we go back even further, one chapter, he starts this whole thing. He doesn't even start with just the women. He starts with slaves. Now, some of you might know what slaves are, and some of you might not. What I want you to know is that slaves were people who were considered lower than other people, okay? So they were people who would have to work for someone else without getting paid, or they would have to kind of come into a kind of agreement to work for someone for a certain amount of time, but they were considered not as important. Now, for my older friends, if you know what slavery is, if you've heard about what slavery used to look like in our country, it's a little bit different in the Bible times, okay? So it was different back then. What is important for us to know is that slaves would not have been spoken to either. And they were even considered lower than women. And so they would not have been spoken to either. But Peter starts this whole thing by talking to the slaves. And he says, you are important. Because you are a believer in Jesus, you are important. You need to know that. And you need to know that before God, you matter. So he uses the slaves even as an example for the women and for the men. So why is that important, friends? Because that means that the truth of the gospel, the good news that Jesus died for us and rose again, means that we are equally important before God. That he loves every single one of you with such love. You are so precious to him. You are important to him. So he is talking to the wives first, and he has some words for the wives, and then he talks to the husbands. But my friends, really, Peter is talking to all of us. And so there are some lessons here that we can learn, and we're going to talk about one in particular. So my next question is, now that we know who Peter was talking to, my question is, what did the world tell the people at the time, and what does the world tell us? Well, we already said that the world told women that they were not as important. The world also told women back then that what was important was that they should look good on the outside. Now, maybe for some of us, we feel like this might be true now too, right? The world tells us that what's important is how we look to other people, right? So that can mean a lot of different things for us, okay? Now, if you look at some of the pictures I have here, we're gonna look at these pictures together. And what does the world tell us about how we should be, who we are? For some of us, looking good on the outside means maybe getting good grades, okay? Or getting into a certain program or a certain school. Maybe that's what is important about who you are, okay? That's what the world tells us. Or maybe it means, like, do you see that trophy there? Maybe it means that the world thinks that we need to win at things, whether it is sports or dance competitions or art competitions or whatever it might be. Maybe that's what the world thinks makes us look good, is winning at things. Maybe it means that we feel like we have to look pretty all the time. There are a lot of people who feel like I always have to look nice. I have to wear certain kinds of clothes. I have to have certain kinds of shoes. I taught middle school a long time ago, and some of my students didn't have a lot of money. Their families came from other countries and were just trying to get by. But for some of my students, the one thing that they would always spend their money on was nice shoes. Because nice shoes, nice sneakers or boots that looked cool, meant that you were cool. And so that's what they would buy, even though their families didn't have a lot of money. So maybe for you, you feel like you have to look a certain way, have a certain haircut, have certain things for us to look good to people. Maybe for some of us, it means having the most toys, or having the newest toys, or having a phone before everybody else, or having the most friends. There are a lot of things that we think make us look good on the outside. For some of us, it's looking good by doing good things. And we feel like we have to always do good things so that people will look at us and think that we are good. So we have to say the right things, do the right things, wear the right things, have the right things. And that's what the world tells us is how we should measure who we are, how we should measure how beautiful we are. It's from the things that we do on the outside. But my friends, here's my third question. What does the Bible tell us? And what does Peter tell us in this passage? Now, in this passage, he puts this under the heading for wives, but I think this is important for all of us to know. It's not just women who have to think about this. It's all of us, children, men, everyone. What does Peter tell them? Peter tells us that what is the most important is not what is on the outside, but what is on the inside, friends. What is on the inside is what matters. Because no matter how great we look on the outside, if we are not pretty on the inside, if we have ugliness on the inside of our hearts, then nothing about us can be beautiful. Now, those things are not bad. It's not bad to like to have nice clothes, or it's not bad to want a new toy. Those things are fine. It's not bad to want to get good grades in school. Those are wonderful things. My question is, friends, why do we want those things? Is it because we think that that will make us more important? That that will make people think that we are good? Because true goodness doesn't come from the outside, friends. True beauty, being beautiful, doesn't come from what you look like or what you have or how much money you have. True beauty comes from what's on the inside of us. Now, I'm gonna show you another picture here. It's one of my favorite Disney movies. And one of my favorites is Beauty and the Beast. Now, there are lots of different reasons why I like that movie in particular, but what I want us to remember, if you have seen it, is how the movie starts. Remember, it starts and it looks almost like a window and explains how the prince became a beast in the first place. Do you remember, friends, how he became a beast? He was rich, right? He was handsome. He had a big castle and servants and everything he could possibly want, but what did that lady say when she came to his house and offered him the magical rose? He closed the door in her face and says she saw that he had no love in his heart. He was nice on the outside. Anyone else would have been like, oh, I wish I could be like that prince and have his castle and his money and everything that he has. But she said, you know what? You are not beautiful on the inside. So I'm just gonna make your outside match what's inside. And that's how he became the beast. And that's an important lesson for us, friends. Now, I don't want us to think that we have to learn all our lessons from Disney movies. So we're gonna look at one in the Bible too. And this verse comes from 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, and it says this, "For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Now, when did we see this verse in the Bible? This was after King Saul was already king. Now, if you remember, King Saul, they chose him because he was tall and he was handsome in appearance. He was nice to look at. He was beautiful on the outside. But as you know, over time, King Saul failed as a king. He was selfish and he was worried about too much about what people thought of him. And so he turned against God. So this verse happens when Samuel the prophet is going to go and anoint another king. And God tells him, I will show you who it is. So he goes to the family of David. And David has many brothers, as you know. And every time one came, Samuel said, is this the one? Is this the one? Because the older brothers were all taller and better looking maybe, or you know, they just look more mature, maybe more kingly. But none of them were the right one. And then God says, don't look at what's on the outside, because people look at what's on the outside, but God looks at the heart. And then who is the one that is chosen? It is David, the youngest brother, the one that maybe you wouldn't expect to be king. But what does the Bible say about King David over and over? It says he was a man after God's own heart. Now, King David made mistakes too. He obviously had sin. But the important thing in this passage that we want to remember is that God looks at our hearts. He's not looking at the outside, friends. He wants to know what's inside. So then here is my last question, friends. If God wants us to be beautiful on the inside, what is it that makes us beautiful on the inside? How can we be beautiful on the inside? The first thing that I want us to remember about being beautiful on the inside is that it is Jesus who transforms us and makes us beautiful on the inside. When we believe in Jesus, that he died to pay the penalty for our sins, then we are transformed, we are changed. And God says in his word that he gives us a new heart It's a new heart. And that is a beautiful heart. So when we believe in Jesus as his children, as God's children, then we can begin to understand who we are in God, in Jesus. And that is what gives us beauty. Second thing is, we can grow in becoming more beautiful on the inside. Because remember what we talked about last time? We still fight with sin, right? There's still sin in our lives that we struggle with. But we can grow in being beautiful on the inside. How do we do that, friends? We do it by fighting against sin, okay? Choosing not to sin. We do it by learning to love God more. And how do we do that, friends? It is always by knowing his word, hearing his word, being in church with a community of believers. By surrounding ourselves with God's word and his people, we can grow in loving our God, and that causes us to grow in our inner beauty. We become more like God, and we are able to sin less, a little bit less. But it is a constant process of growing and becoming more beautiful on the inside, instead of focusing on what's on the outside. And friends, the good news for us is that God is the one who is doing this work in us. He is the one who is changing our hearts, and he is the one who is working on us and making us more beautiful. So friends, we do what we can do, and we read his word, and we ask him to continue to change us, and then we focus on working on our hearts, on becoming beautiful on the inside, like Peter says to his readers in the New Testament times. Friends, I hope that for all of us, that we would desire to be beautiful on the inside and not just on the outside. Even though people around us and the world around us might say, it's more important to look good on the outside. But friends, what God looks at is our heart. And so my friends, I hope that all of our hearts would be turned to God so that we can learn to love him more and grow in being more like Christ. I have a little experiment that I'm going to show us to kind of demonstrate what I'm talking about here, and then we'll wrap it up. All right, friends, I have something that I've been working on that I want to show you that will help us to remember what we learned today, which is that God looks at what is on the inside. He cares about us being beautiful on the inside, even though the world might tell us that we need to be beautiful on the outside and that that's more important. So I have 2 cups of water here. This one, I have taken great care to make the outside look pretty. Look at that. I've added some red and clear gems. And then on the stem here, I've added some pretty silver tape. And even on the bottom, I added this row of gems again to make sure it's super pretty on the outside. Now, this other cup over here, I haven't really done anything at all to the outside, but I have been taking care of the inside. You can see I've been stirring it a lot. It's getting a little bubbly because I keep stirring it so much. I've been stirring it and making sure that it has everything that it needs on the inside, that it's perfect and clear, and that it's exactly what I need it to be. Okay, so I'm taking care of the inside of this cup and the outside of the other cup. Now, friends, when it comes time for the love of Jesus to shine, which one do you think is going to shine more brightly? Maybe the one with the pretty outside, or maybe the one that I've taken care of on the inside. So I'm going to show you. I'm going to turn off the light. It's going to get dark for a second. Now, when you look at the first cup on the outside, I mean, it still looks okay, right? You can sort of see the gems, but there's not really much beauty on the inside of the cup, is there? No, because I spent so much time on the outside. But this cup, friends, can you see that? I spent a lot of time taking care of the inside of this cup, and you can see that when we take care of the inside, when we want to be beautiful on the inside by loving our God, knowing his word, and loving people, that this is where the love of Jesus really shines, from our inner beauty, because we've taken care of the inside of our cup. And that is cool, right? So friends, that was just what I wanted to show you, a little experiment about what it means to be beautiful on the inside instead of just focusing on the outside. And my friends, my prayer for all of us is that we would be growing in our love for God, learning to love him more, becoming more like Jesus. Thank you for joining me. I'm super excited to be able to spend this time with you, and I really do hope to see you all again soon, okay? Have a great week. I'll see you next time. Bye.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi.